In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace and peace of God our Father, the love of the Son, of Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship and union of God's Spirit be always with you.
Amen.
My friends, as we gather to celebrate the Eucharist today on the second Sunday of Lent, we hear God telling us, listen to him as he speaks primarily through the scriptures to us today. In the first reading and the gospel, they're really good texts, and yet at the same time, they're very puzzling texts. In the gospel, we hear God's voice from the heaven directing Peter, James, and John, Jesus' closest friends and disciples. He says, listen to Jesus. You and I can use this reminder as well. Are we listening to him? How is Jesus speaking to us today as we pray? As we hear God's word, as we celebrate this liturgy in memory of what he has done for us. So for the times that we have not listened to what the Lord has asked us, let us pause and ask for his forgiveness.
Lord Jesus, you are God's beloved Son. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you were transfigured in glory, revealing the splendor of the life to come. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the way that leads us out of darkness into God's wonderful light. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
The Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sin, and may he bring us to life everlasting.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who have commanded us to listen to your beloved Son, be pleased, we pray, to nourish us inwardly by your word, that with spiritual sight made pure, we may rejoice to behold your glory. For our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Son, I will bless you abundantly, and make your descendants as countless as the stars of the sky and the sands of the seashore. Your descendants shall take possession of the gates of their enemies, and in your descendants all the nations of the earth shall find blessings. All this because you obeyed my command. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but handed him over for all of us, how will he not also give us everything else along with him? Who will bring a charge against God's chosen ones? It is God who acquits us, who will condemn. Christ Jesus it is who died, or rather was raised, who also at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. The word of the Lord.
Appeared to them along with Moses, and they were conversing Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus in reply, "Rabbi, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He hardly knew what to say. They were so terrified. Then a cloud came, casting a shadow over them. From the cloud came a voice, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." Suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone but Jesus alone with them. As they were coming down the mountain, he charged them not to relate what they had seen to anyone, except when the Son of Man had risen from the dead. So they kept the matter to themselves, questioning what rising from the dead meant. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
How's everybody today? You're fine. You know, the first reading of the Gospel, as I said, are somewhat puzzling. But they're both very powerful readings for us. They're important because they convey to us how important it is for us to be attentive to what God is sharing to us through the scriptures. But when you get to readings like we've heard from Genesis and from the Gospel today, sometimes I think we end up with more questions than we do answers. I think what we have to try to do is remind ourselves that we should become familiar with the scriptures, that we should reflect on them, that we should pray over them, and we pray for clarity so that we know what God is saying and really not what we want him to say. And also, I think what these readings tell us today is that we have to bring ourselves to be comfortable with those things that we just can't jump. So I think we have to listen and we have to be mindful of what God is asking of us. The reading from Genesis gives us a very puzzling reading, I think, because we have Abraham being asked to sacrifice his son Isaac. I remember that Abraham and his wife Sarah were very old, and God said that they not only would have a son, but also God promised Abraham that his descendants would be as numerable as the sand of the seashore. But you and I know that we can't count this number of grains of sand on the seashore. That would be certainly an unending task and would be useless. God not only blessed Abraham and Sarah with Isaac, but he asked him something that in this instance is puzzling, because he asked him to sacrifice the gift that God gave him, the blessing of Isaac, and asked him to sacrifice him. Well, why would God do that? And we also have to ask, well, is God really asking him to do that? Asking him to offer human sacrifice? Abraham and Sarah were among the Canaanites, and the Canaanite people did offer human sacrifice to their gods. But as we know at the end of the narrative, God stopped Abraham from sacrificing Isaac and gave him a ram in his place. And many scripture scholars think that that's an indication that God is against human sacrifice. If we look at it the other way, it certainly was contrary to parental responsibility. parental love for their children. It was also prefiguring in many ways the fact that God gave his only Son to us in reparation so that he could reconcile us to himself by the outpouring of the love of his Son. The gospel that we just heard Deacon Joe proclaim tells us of the transfiguration where Peter, James, and John went with Jesus up onto this mountain, and before their eyes, Jesus was transfigured. And also, not only was Jesus transfigured and changed like they had never seen him before, but also there appeared Moses and Elijah. And these just weren't figments of their imagination. They were real. Peter wanted Jesus to allow them to build some temporary homes for them so that they would stay there. Jesus didn't want that. Moses was there perhaps to see the connection between Jesus and the covenant, since God's covenant was given to Moses on Mount Sinai, and here they find themselves on Mount Tabor. Elijah was there as well. Elijah was there to show the continuance between the covenant and the prophets. And Jesus was there to show God's love, his Son, in our midst, saying that this is my beloved Son. What does he say of his beloved Son? Listen to him. And that's what God asks us to do. Listen to him. I don't know about you, but it seems as though we're further along in Lent than just the second week. We're only at the beginning of the second week of Lent, and maybe we have to ask ourselves whether or not we are listening to God. Minds and our hearts and our whole being open to him. Open as Abraham was when he was ready to sacrifice his son Isaac. Are we open to him so that he may change us? Maybe we're fighting that change. Maybe God wants us to go down a different path and we're putting up our hands and saying, no way. A couple of weeks ago, actually, I think it was the second Sunday of Ordinary Time, which was right after the baptism of Jesus, which concluded our Christmas season, we heard the reading of God calling Samuel. He called him three times, Samuel, Samuel. Samuel got up in the middle of the night and responded, here I am. Second time he called him, he said the same thing. Maybe by the second time I would have said, go fly a kite. But the third time, God called Samuel. And I think the story of Abraham gives us a similar indication that God is with us, because he called Abraham three times. And God, Abraham responded, I am here. I think as we continue our journey in Lent, we have to ask ourselves, are we here listening to him? Today we have the great responsibility and also the great pleasure of preparing two of our young people who have been baptized previously, Charlotte and Jay McDonald, but they haven't received First Holy Communion, or they haven't received confirmation yet, and we're preparing them for those sacraments. And so today, as our adult catechumens would go to St. Peter's Cathedral tomorrow, what we do here tonight reflects that same willingness of them presenting themselves to God, listening to what he has to say, their mother, and then listening to what he has to say, and taking the plunge and saying, yes, Lord, here I am. and this is what I want for my children. So at this point, I'm going to ask Charlotte and Jade to come up before the altar. I'm going to ask their mom, Elaine, to come up and also stand with them. Since you have already been baptized, what do you ask of God's church for Charlotte and Jay?
In the presence of the community, they may be knowing that they have been received into the church.
In bringing Charlotte and Jay to the church, you are undertaking the responsibility of raising them in the faith, so that keeping God's commandments, they may love the Lord and his neighbor, as Christ taught us. Do you understand this responsibility?
I do.
Charlotte and Jade, with great joy, the Church of God gives thanks with your mom who welcomes you and the people of our parish who pray for you and testifies that you have already been received by the Church. In her name, I sign you with the sign of Christ, who has bestowed life upon you in baptism and joined you to his Church. God, who did not spare his own Son, but handed him over for us, may we offer now our intercessions.
And our response this evening will be, Lord, in your mercy. That Pope Francis, his brother bishops, and all the members of the Church may reveal Jesus' compassion to the world and to one another through healing gestures of reconciliation, we pray.
Lord, in your mercy.
That a transformation of hearts and spirits may stay the hand of powers and interests that any way threaten to sacrifice peace in a holocaust of hate, we pray.
Lord, in your mercy.
That justice and compassion may guide the national conversation on the status of the immigrants among us and special interests do not get in the way of common sense gun legislation, we pray.
Lord, have mercy.
That those tested in faith may find in Abraham a source of strength and inspiration, and those who feel unwanted or unloved, a place of welcome and belonging in our community, we pray.
Lord, have mercy.
That having listened to God's beloved Son, we may always leave this holy mountain of word and worship, strengthened for bearing witness to the faith and for loosening the bonds of the afflicted, we pray.
Lord, have mercy.
That our first responders, essential workers, and servicemen and women may be covered with safety, and the seriously ill in our community and among our family members and friends, gifted with loving care and the healing touch of our God. We especially pray for Christine Hingos, Dennis Soda, we pray.
Lord, have mercy.
That Easter's glorious promise may be the hope of those in mourning and all who sorrow for the victims of gun violence. We especially pray this evening for Deacon Stephen Napoli, Brittany Heaney, and our Mass intention, Frank Barbarito, and all our beloved dead, may they come to eternal rest and the everlasting embrace of God's peace and love, we pray.
Lord, have mercy.
We pause to express in silence of our hearts our personal intentions. That God may receive with a special kindness those unspoken concerns, we pray.
Lord, have mercy.
God of faithful love, listen to the prayer of your people, gathered to celebrate this memorial of your everlasting covenant. Strengthen within us the gift of obedient faith, that all our days we may follow in the footsteps of the transfigured and holy one. This we pray in the name of Jesus, who is Lord, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Let us sing.
friends, pray that my sacrifice and yours will be accepted by God, our Father Almighty.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice and yours.
May this sacrifice, Lord, we pray, cleanse us of our faults and sanctify your faithful in body and mind for the celebration of Easter festivities. And we pray this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For after he had told the disciples of his coming death, on the holy mountain he manifested to them his glory, to show even by the testimony of the law and the prophets that the passion leads to the glory of the resurrection. And so with the powers of heaven, we worship you constantly on earth. Before your majesty, without end, we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the cup, gave you thanks, and gave the cup to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith. Grant that by the spirit of your love, we may be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion. By our partaking of this mystery, Almighty Father, give us life through your Spirit. Grant that we may be conformed to the image of your Son. Confirm us in the bond of communion, together with Francis our Pope, with our Bishop Joseph, and with your entire people. Grant that all the faithful of the Church, looking into the signs of times by the light of faith, may constantly devote themselves to the service of the gospel. Keep us attentive to the needs of all, that sharing their grief and pain, their joy and hope, we may faithfully bring them the good news of salvation and go forward with them along the way of your kingdom. Remember our sisters and brothers who have fallen asleep in the peace of Christ and all the debtors' faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and at the resurrection give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever. There, in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the apostles and martyrs, with Vincent and Boyle, and with all the saints, we shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Thank you. happy are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Keep them faithful to the gospel of your only begotten Son, so that they may always desire and at last attain that glory whose beauty he showed in his own body to the amazement of his apostles, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
May the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come upon us and may remain with us forever.
Amen.
Our masks ended, let us go in peace, glorifying God in our lives.
Thanks be to God.
Have a good night.
You too.
Bye-bye. central intelligence. I just go. LaCorte.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Have a great day.
Have a good one, Father John.
Thanks, you too. Thanks, Dan.
You're welcome.
Always good to be up here.